If we want to go to heaven, we need a total transformation. We need it as individuals, and we need it as a church. And the time has come to speak about these things, because we are told that the straight testimony will cause the shaking. To have a total transformation. This is probably the hardest thing to do. Am I my brother's keeper? Our guide text. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Let's just go through this Elijah experience. Elijah the Tishbite said unto Ahab, "As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word." And then she writes, "Among the mountains of Gilead, east of the Jordan, there dwelt in the days of Ahab a man of faith and prayer." Now remember that he is a type. There's an anti-typical Elijah, isn't there? So this gives us an idea. Yeah, he wasn't part of general society. He was separate. He lived there amongst the mountains of Gilead, east of the Jordan. A man of faith and prayer. Fearless ministry. Fearless. He was destined to check the rapid spread of apostasy in Israel. Nice job, eh? Nope. Not the nicest of jobs. Removed from any city of renown. Occupying no high station in life. Elijah the Tishbite nevertheless entered upon his mission confident in God's purpose to prepare the way before him and to give him abundant success. The word of faith and power was upon his lips. And this is what we all must be like, because we are all anti-typical Elijahs. His whole life was devoted to the work of reform. His was the voice of one crying in the wilderness to rebuke sin, press back the tide of evil. And while he came to the people as a reprover of sin, his message offered the balm of Gilead. He lived there amongst the mountains of Gilead to the sin-sick souls of all who desired to be healed. That's probably the nicest description I've ever read of the duty of the end time Elijah. That's what we have to be like. That's what we've got to attain to. And it's not the best job description that one can imagine. Genesis 4 verse 9, "And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper?" What does that mean? The word there is shamar. Shomar. A primitive root, probably to hedge about, as with thorns. That is to guard, protect, attend, beware, be circumspect, take heed, keep, mark, look narrowly, observe, preserve, regard, reserve, save, self, sure, wait, watch. That's heavy. That's a big job description. Keep. That's a mighty job description. Am I my brother's keeper? Well, the church is one body. In the second epistle to the Corinthians, writing to the Gentile Christians, Paul says, "And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." So this church is the temple of the living God. It's not a temple of stone. It's a temple of people. Ephesians 2:13-22, "But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace who has made both one, and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain, of two, one new man, so making peace. And that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross," the body of Christ, "having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off and to them that were nigh." Everybody, those were far off, that were nigh, called into this one body, Christ's body. He died for them. "For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father." So here is a conglomerate of people. There's no Greek, there's no Jew, one people coming into this body. "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit." So the church is special. It's got all these people, and its cornerstone is Christ, and it's a habitation of God through the Spirit. It's powerful stuff. Acts 15:22, "Then pleased it the apostles and the elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, surnamed Barsabbas, and Silas, chief men amongst the brethren. And they wrote letters by them after this manner: the apostles and the elders and the brethren sent greetings unto the brethren which are of the Gentiles in Antioch and Syria and Cilicia." What does it say there? I'm such a troubler of Israel. That's the King James Version. Now, who's the church here? This is important stuff. We've got to be very sure who's the church. "Then it pleased the apostles and the elders," what's it say? "With the whole church." Verse 23, "And they," who's the they? So I want to know, who's the they? They wrote letters by them after this manner, the apostles and the elders and the brethren. So who's the church? Everyone in it. Everyone in it. There's a hierarchy, yes. But when it comes to decisions, it's the whole church. The whole church. Now, theoretically, we have such a structure in the Seventh-day Adventist church. No doctrine can be changed until there is a general assembly. It takes place once every 5 years, and everybody corporately has to vote. We don't have a papacy. We don't have one man who can change the lives and the doctrines of all the people in the church. Other churches, of course, have synods, where they have the apostles and the elders and the others all kicked out. So that's not the church. They have a few people deciding for many. This is the truth. And they wrote letters by them after this manner, the apostles and the elders and the brethren sent greetings. Pleased the apostles and the elders with the whole church to send. We are one corporate body of Christ. Now, these texts can't please the Roman Catholic hierarchy. So if you take the NIV, then it reads, with them they sent the following letters, the apostles and elders, comma, and your brothers to the Gentile believers in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia. Ah! So they've separated an elite group of ecclesia above the brethren. If you go to the Good News Bible, they sent the following letters by them. Gone. Everything's gone. So you go from a whole church to a couple of leaders, and the rest is nothing, to absolutely nothing. Well, as for me personally, I like the received text. And I think God's structure is based on that. Now, this church, which consists of the apostles, the elders, and the whole church, are a peculiar people. They're a special people. They're a holy people. They're a strange people. They're odd. You must agree they're odd, right? They're set apart. Deuteronomy 14:2, for thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God, and the Lord has chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself. It's just coincidence that in the English, this word peculiar has this double connotation, but it fits like a hat, doesn't it? Unto himself above all the nations that are upon the earth. And the Lord has avouched thee this day to be his peculiar people, as he has promised thee, and that thou shouldst keep all his commandments. That makes us peculiar, makes us odd, makes us strange. I don't know how you can fit that square peg into an ecumenical round hole. It just doesn't fit. If you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Here's a special people. Consists of all of these factions. The walls of separation have been taken down, and they're God's special treasure. Psalms 135 verse 4, for the Lord has chosen Jacob unto himself and Israel for his peculiar treasure. Here's this odd little group on the planet, and they are his special people. Titus 2:14, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. A chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. Why? So that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Isn't that a nice description of the church? This is how God sees it. He sees this and he sees it like, how shall I say, the wife of Abraham. Stunning. Pharaoh's eyes would go going, knee-bucklingly beautiful. That's how he sees her. She wasn't perfect. She wasn't totally honest, but she was beautiful. We are as a people to guard ourselves diligently, lest we forget the charges of the Lord. There are many dangers that we shall avoid if we keep ourselves a distinct people, separate from the world. Our children are the Lord's heritage, to be educated and disciplined, and that most faithfully, to obey God and keep all the words of the Lord in obeying his commandments. Parents are responsible to God for strictly guarding their children in the path of obedience to God. Here's this weird group, 9 manuscripts release. Let's give them a name. Seventh-day Adventists have been chosen by God as a peculiar people, separate from the world. By the great cleaver of truth, he has cut them out from the quarry of the world and brought them into connection with himself. So who are these people? The Seventh-day Adventists. Not because they're the bee's knees, not because they're great, but because God is great. He has made them his representatives and has called them to be ambassadors for him in the last work of salvation. This message is for the church. The greatest wealth of truth ever entrusted to mortals, the most solemn and fearful warnings ever sent by God to man, have been committed to them to be given to the world. Isn't that an incredible commission? Wow! And we want to hide our face in a little bushel and disappear into an ecumenical oblivion? Does that make any sense? And in the accomplishment of this work, our publishing houses are among the most effective agencies. Get literature out, literature, literature. And a DVD is literature, isn't it? Yes. Yes, it's literature. It's written on silicon. It's stones crying out, isn't it? And we must teach sound doctrine. Those who have seen the truth and felt its importance, have had an experience in the things of God, are to teach sound doctrine to their children. Not gobbledygook. Sound doctrine. So if you want to know where to find sound doctrine, you'll find it in the Bible and you'll find it in the Spirit of Prophecy. That's where you'll find sound doctrine. They should make them acquainted with the great pillars of our faith. The reasons why we are Seventh-day Adventists. I said right in the beginning, I'm not going to make any bones about it. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I'm not just any Christian. Why are we called, as were the children of Israel, to be a peculiar people, a holy nation, separate and distinct from the other people on the face of the earth? These things should be explained to the children in simple language, easy to be understood. Do we still do that as a church? Whew. And as they grow in years, the lessons imparted should be suited to their increasing capacity. until the foundations of truth have been laid broad and deep. If we had done this continuously, what a powerhouse this church would be. Wow. As a people, we are looked upon as peculiar. I still remember my poor wife, the first day we went to eat ever with Adventists. We took our kids with us, and she lasted about an hour, and she says, she can't stand it anymore, can we go? And I said, we can leave the kids, let's go. And we left for about 3 hours, through which she cried, the whole 3 hours. And then we went back to those peculiar people. What a nightmare. And we're still with them. Our position and faith distinguish us from every other denomination. If we are in life and character no better than the world, they will point the finger of scorn at us and say, these are Seventh-day Adventists. Look at them. We have here a sample of the people who keep the seventh day of Sunday. What a weird bunch. The stigma which should be rightfully attached to such a class as thus placed upon all who are conscientiously keeping the seventh day. Oh, how much better it would be if such a class would not make any pretension to obey the truth. These are great statements, aren't they? And the specific objectives of our literature. Our publishing work was established by the direction of God and under His special supervision. It was designed to accomplish a specific purpose. Seventh-day Adventists have been chosen by God as a peculiar people separate from the world by the great cleaver of truth. We read that all before. Great wealth of truth ever entrusted to mortals, solemn, fearful warnings ever sent by God to man have been given to this church. Publishing houses, send it out. No, we send out Rick Warren these days. Sad. There are many in the church who at heart belong to the world. How many? Many. But God calls upon those who claim to believe the advanced truth to rise above the present attitude of the popular churches of today. Where is self-denial? Where is the cross-bearing that Christ has said should characterize His followers? The reason we have had so little influence upon unbelieving relatives and associates is that we have manifested little decided difference in our practice from those of the world. We're just like them. Parents need to awake and purify their souls by practicing the truth in their home. When we reach the standard that the Lord would have us reach, I love this statement, worldlings will regard Seventh-day Adventists as odd, singular, straight-laced extremists. We are made a spectacle unto the world and to angels and to men. Do the people see you as odd, singular, straight-laced extremists? If they don't, there's a problem. Not with them, but with us. The Redeemer of the world does not sanction experience and exercise in religious matter independent of His organized and acknowledged church. Now we're getting into trouble. This church, God wants us to experience His leading in the pillar of cloud and fire in this church. Many have an idea that they are responsible to Christ alone for their light and experience, so they want to serve a head without a body, independent of His recognized followers on earth. But in the history of the conversion of Paul, important principles are given us, which we should ever bear in mind. He was brought directly into the presence of Christ. He was one whom Christ intended for a most important work, one who was to be a chosen vessel unto Him, yet He did not personally impart to him the lessons of truth. He arrested his course, convicted him, and asked him, "What wilt thou have me do?" The Savior placed him in connection with the church and let them direct him what to do. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. I'm part of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I cannot work independently of my church. There are many in the church who drive me nuts. But this is his church, and I will work in his church. They have a startling message. As John prepared the way for the first, so we are to prepare the way for the second advent of Jesus. We must exalt the Sabbath. We must say obedience to all his commandments. Constrained by the love of Christ, they are to cooperate with him in building up the old waste places, raising up the foundations of many generations. We've got to say, this is where you went wrong, guys. Reformed churches, look where you've been and look where you are. Come on, let's repair the breach. Restorers of paths to dwell in. Through the testimony of the Sabbath, the fourth commandment is to stand as a witness, a constant reminder of God to attract notice and arouse investigation that shall direct the minds of men to their Creator. They are to herald the three angels' messages. There's no other church on this planet that does that. Let it never be forgotten that these institutions are to cooperate with the ministry of the delegates of heaven. They are among the agencies presented by the angels flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel. Hour of his judgment has come. That's our job. We've got to emphasize special truths. We are under obligation to declare faithfully the whole counsel of God. There's no patchwork. Here, we are not to make less prominent the special truths that have separated us from the world and made us what we are. Is there a tendency to do that today? To make them less prominent? No. We are to make them prominent. For they are fraught with eternal interest. God has given us light in regard to the things that are now taking place in the last remnant of time. And with pen and voice, we are to proclaim the truth to the world, not in a tame, spiritless way, but in demonstration of the Spirit and the power of God. Go. That's your job. That's the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And then it says in 1 Peter 2, verse 17, honor all men. That means I must show the necessary honor to all people on the planet, including leaders, apostate or not, Herods, who kill people, Agrippas, you name it, we've got them all. Paul was straight. He told them their sins, but he was courteous. And then this word, love. The brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. And whenever the Bible talks about love for the brethren, it always uses the word agapeo. Agape love. Phew. If it wasn't that word, we'd be dead meat. Because this is the selfless love that God alone can impart. It's not the, oh, how I love you, check, slack, 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 love. Thank you for that. This is a higher love. If it said something else there, we'd be in trouble. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. For whoever shall do the will of the Father in heaven, the same is my brother and sister and mother. So God has called the people to do the will of the Father in heaven. He's called them Seventh-day Adventists because the name is a rebuke to the world. And if they do the will, that's your brother, your sister, your mother. We know what That's what sin is. It's the transgression of the law. And if we abide in him, we sin not. Galatians, as we therefore have opportunity, let us do good unto all men. And then that little word there, especially unto them of the household of the faith. Where is our first obligation? Here. Here. There's a tendency in the world today to make the first obligation there. Out there. I have to preach the message out there. But my obligations are strictly tied to my church. Now this church consists of individuals. We're all individuals. We're not robots. So we being many are one body in Christ and everyone member one of another. Romans 12 verse 5. We're one, but we're individuals. 1 John 2 verse 9, he that says he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. I have to love these brethren. That's hard. As I've said before, it's easy to love the truth. It's easy to love Jesus. It's easy to stand for the truth until I die. Chop me up, Lord, for the truth. But love the brethren. Can't you give me something else, please? Anything but that. The brethren. The brethren. Love the brethren. 1 John 3, 10 to 18. And this, the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever does not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. Wow, this must be important. This is the ultimate test. Love the brethren. For this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil and his brothers were righteous. It's been like that all along. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. This is a life and death story. This is not just anything. This is serious. You love me? Says Jesus. You really love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Come, let's check it out. I'll put you with the brethren. That's tough, right? Ooh. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. Wow. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. If you don't love the brethren, you don't have eternal life. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso has the world's good and sees his brother have need and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. 1 John 4, 20 to 21. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he has seen, how can he love God, whom he has not seen? In this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God, love his brother also. Ultimate test of the true nature of our relationship with Christ. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begat loveth him also that is begotten of him. But this we know, that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. And whoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. For as the body is one, and has many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. You can't love Christ without loving his body. You have to have them both. But Lord, the body is so unlovable. What do I do with your unlovable body? While you were yet a sinner, I died for you. And you want to despise the brethren? For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he has done, whether it be good or bad. So we're all these individuals. And we have our individuality. And that does not negate our corporateness. We're corporate. Romans 4:10, why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. This is the ultimate test. Thousands will be lost because they don't love the brethren. And thousands will never come into the unity with Christ's church because they despise the brethren. I'm not going to join that group. Don't we hear that all the time? I don't want to be a member of the church. They're weird. They're supposed to be weird. So that you can learn to love them. Christ recognized no distinction. Christ recognized no distinction of nationality, rank, or creed. Christ came to break down every wall of partition. He came to show that his gift of mercy and love is as unconfined as the air, the light, or the showers of rain that refresh the earth. The life of Christ established a religion in which there is no caste, a religion by which Jew, Gentile, free, bond are linked in a common brotherhood, equal before God. Boom, there goes the NIV distinction between the hierarchy and the brethren. No question of policy influenced his movements. He made no difference between neighbors and strangers, friends and enemies. That which appealed to his heart was a soul thirsting for the waters of life. If ever there was someone who had reason on occasion to hate the brethren, it was probably me. And there was a time when I hated some of the brethren. Even some of the leading brethren. I hated them. My favorite text was, "Oh, how I hate them that hate thee, O Lord." That was my favorite text. I came home once from a mega campaign. I actually had to send my home my wife, because I think she would have died. She couldn't stand the attacks anymore. She just faded away. I had to send her home on an early plane. Change the plane. Go home. You won't survive this. And when I came home from that trip, I sat in a chair for 3 months. This is not a lie. And just stared. And got up from that chair, carried on with my life, with hate in my heart. I hated the brethren. And I had reason to hate the brethren. They are not lovable. You cannot love them. Or so I thought. And I walked with a hate in my heart for a long, long time for the brethren. Years. And wrestled with it. That's bad, eh? You can't live with it. And you can't be a child of God if you have that in your heart. You can't operate. And I wrestled with it, and I wrestled with it, and I wrestled with it. And one day, I was walking in the mountain, and I sat down and I said, "God, I can't live with it. Take it away. Take it away." And he did. He took it away. I don't hate the brethren. I love them. I don't like them. But I love them. I want them all to be saved. And the worse they are, the more we must love them. Because just think, if they don't change, where they're going. No hope. Nothing. What a privilege to have hope and all these beautiful things that God has promised. We must love the brethren. And the worse they are, the more we must love them. If we can manage that, we'll be just fine. He sought to inspire with hope the roughest and the most unpromising, setting them before them the assurance that they might become blameless and harmless. And they're in the church. There are many, the most unpromising and the most pathetic and the roughest. They're in this church. And many of them are hurting. And many hate the brethren. We have hate for the brethren in this church like you cannot believe. One gentle answer, one gentle touch, and their whole life can change. In the Christian life, we are not assured that we shall be freed from trials, but that that grace will be given us to bear them. We are individually called to go through temptation and trial, but the object for which they are permitted to come upon us is that we may be perfected in grace and love. That the image of selfishness may disappear and the image of Christ appear in our character. What did Moses do when they treated him shamefully, when they despised his counsel, when they were vindictive? And when the Lord said, step aside, I'll wipe them out for you. And I'll make a nation out of you. What did he do? Thank God for the relief. No. Blot me from the book of life, that they may be saved. Wow. The members of his church will be individually tested and proved. We shall be individually be called upon to act in building up the cause of God in the earth, in the vindicating God's law, and in lifting up the Savior as the Lamb of God which taketh away the sins of the world. Individually called in the church. And every one of us should investigate the truth for ourselves. We must be totally convinced individually. As a people, we are called individually to be students of prophecy. You cannot use the church as a crutch. You cannot blame the church for any deficiencies in your education as far as any of these things are concerned. The Lord has put into this church everything you need. And it's up to us individually to make sure that we do it right. We must watch with earnestness that we discern any ray of light which God shall present to us. We are to catch the first gleamings of truth, and through prayerful study, clearer light may be obtained, which can be brought before others. We are individuals in the church. The greatest wisdom, the most essential, is the knowledge of God. Self sinks into insignificance as it contemplates God and Jesus Christ whom he has sent. The Bible must be made the foundation for all study. Individually, we must learn from this lesson book what God has given us. We have no excuse. We cannot say, Lord, I'm in the church and the church is pathetic. It hasn't taught me anything. I've received no light. The pastor preaches weak, lame messages. I fall asleep in his services. I can't stand it anymore. He's not responsible for your spirituality. We are responsible for our own spirituality. Don't blame it on the pastor. Don't blame it on the elders. We are responsible. For it is the only book that tells us what we must do in order to be saved. Not only this, but from its strength may be received for intellect. The many books which education is thought to embrace are misleading, a deception, and a delusion. What is the chaff to the wheat? Satan is now stirring up the minds of men to furnish to the world literature which is of a cheap, superficial order. I walk into these Adventist homes and all this garbage is there and they're reading it. They will accept anything as long as it's not from the spirit of prophecy. Have you noticed that? When it comes to health, they read everybody. If somebody gets up in a camp meeting, as they did in Africa recently, prominent people, and they say, you have to eat this, that, and the other to stay alive, everybody gives up their healthy lifestyle and goes along that track. Where did they get it from? Why jump when somebody says jump? Read for yourself. What does the spirit of prophecy say? We wouldn't have to go wrong. We cannot blame the church for our condition. After reading this book, the mind lives in an unreal world, and the life, so far as usefulness is concerned, is as barren as a fruitless tree. The brain is intoxicated, making it impossible. And even if the Pope himself hands you books to read, doesn't mean you have to read them. If your church hands out books and says, this is what we need in this generation, and it comes from the pen of a Freemason, then say, thank you for the book. It's good for heating in the winter. A mind educated to feed upon trash is unable to see in the Word of God the beauty that is there. It's just a fact. The more you read this stuff, the more you go astray. This is the richest church in the world. Why not read from the fountain of richness? Love for Jesus and inclination to righteousness are lost, for the mind is built up from that upon which it feeds. By feeding the mind upon exciting stories, fiction, and believe you me, those books which are handed out sometimes in our church are nothing other than fiction. They're worse than fiction. They're wood, they're hay, they're stubble. He loses all taste for the divine guidebook. And that's our problem. But don't blame the church. Don't blame the church. Church is not responsible. We're responsible for what we read. We are not saved as a sect. No denominational name has any virtue to bring us into favor with God. We are saved individually as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. And by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. We may have our names recorded on the books of the most spiritual of churches, and yet we may not belong to Christ, and our names may not be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Straight. He made an infinite sacrifice because it was the only way whereby man could be saved. Those who believe in Christ will reveal it in life and character. By beholding Christ, they will be changed into his image, and Christ will be represented to the world by his followers. If we are the branches of the true vine, precious clusters of rich fruit will appear in the life as the natural result. We must study these things. I like this man. He's one of my favorite men. Yeah, you knock him over, someone else, Melanchthon, will pick him up. Martin Luther, in his work, The Freedom of the Christian Man, lays down two principles based on 1 Corinthians 9:19. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all that I might gain the more. He says, the Christian is perfectly free, Lord of all, subject to none. Second principle, the Christian is perfectly dutiful, servant to all, subject to all. Isn't that gorgeous? Man, this man had wisdom. The second principle must rest on the first principle, or else the Christian experience becomes one of slavery. In right relationship to each other, the two principles become a blessing. And this is what we must learn in the church. We must not look at the individuals. We must not look at what they do. We have to, of course, be watchmen on the walls of Zion. But that has to do with salvation. It doesn't matter what they do. It doesn't matter. We have to get to that point or else we'll go nuts. The work committed to us by the Lord will advance rapidly only when we labor in unity. Yes is one. This is exactly what I believe in consolidation, but Christian unity is not what the world calls consolidation. Unity amongst brethren results in consolidation with Christ and with heavenly angels. Such consolidation is heavenly born. So there are principles here. Unity doesn't mean that I become a lackey to nonsense. Consolidation tends to exalt the human. The policy of consolidation, this is all spirit of prophecy. Wherever pursuits tends to the exaltation of the human in place of the divine. So if you're in an ecumenical movement, that's human. The divine is gone. You're going to sacrifice him for the sake of unity, isn't it? You'll have to. Those who bear responsibilities in the different institutions look to central authority for guidance and support. Nonsense. As the sense of personal responsibility is weakened, they lose the highest and most precious of all human experiences, the constant dependence of the soul upon God. If we constantly say, well, what do they say? We'll never get anything done. Not realizing their need, they fail to maintain that constant watchfulness and prayer, that constant surrender to God. That's why Ellen White says, the congregation seldom rises above the norms and standards of the pastor. Who's the pastor? Is he the example, the be-all and the end-all? Or is Jesus the example, the be-end and the end-all? We have to start looking at ourselves in this church. If you will only work in and through the Holy Spirit, you will have a comforter with you all the time. It does not matter what this one or that one may say. You are not amenable to any man. You are amenable to God. He has given you your work and He is making a way for you so that you can work in His name. We are called individually. Notwithstanding frequent counsel to the contrary, men continue to plan for centralization of power by binding of many interests under one control. Control freaks. This work was first started in the Review and Herald offered. Things were swayed first in one way, then in another. It was the enemy of our work who prompted the call for the consolidation of the publishing work under one controlling power in Battle Creek. That's a principle. The apostles, the elders, the brethren. Then the idea gained favor that the medical missionary work would be greatly advanced if all our medical institutions and other medical missionary interests were bound up under the control of the Medical Missionary Association of Battle Creek. And so we start institutions which tell you how you must react, how you must believe, and if you believe differently or act differently, boy, boom, you get into trouble. I was told that I must lift my voice in warning against this. We are not to be under the control of men who would not control themselves and were not willing to be amenable to God. We were not to be guided by men who want their word to be the controlling power. Who are we responsible to? We're responsible to God. And yet we must love the brethren. All right, how are we then corporate if we're all individuals in this little box doing his own thing? And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites amongst whom I dwell. Here is a typology. He wanted to keep it in the family of God. All relationships are in the family of God. And yet, that individual, yet corporate. Jacob was left alone. All by himself. Salvation is an individual thing. He wrestled a man with him until the breaking of day, and when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh. I must do a whole lecture on thigh. One on feet and one on thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day breaketh." And he said, "I will not let thee go, lest ye bless me." And he said unto him, "What is thy name?" And he said, "Jacob." And he said, "Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed." That's powerful. Wow. So we have to wrestle with God individually. We have to cling. And if our hip is out of joint, then it's out of joint. Well, my hip is out of joint. Doesn't the Bible say the two shall be one flesh? So my hip's out of joint too. Your wife's hip's out of joint, your hip is out of joint. That's fine, Lord. I'm not going to stand next to her when the Lord comes, because that hip's going to come flying out for the replacement part. God said unto Jacob, "Arise, go up to Bethel, house of God, and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau, thy brother." Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him. We're now going from individual to what? Corporate. Individual experience, individual wrestling with God, and now he's going to the house of God, Bethel. Isn't it amazing that this was a pagan country, and yet God designed the names of the cities and the dwelling places to fit his typology? Isn't that gorgeous? And these are not made up names, these are literal real names. They existed, you can find them in the archaeology. Then Jacob said unto his household and all that were with him, "Put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments." So when you become a Christian, if you've had this individual experience, suddenly things start to change. The idols are gone. The mini skirt gets discarded. The revealing things go. And let us rise and go up to Bethel, house of God, and I will make there an altar unto God. Worship of Christ, the atonement, who answered me in the day of my distress and was with me in the way I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods, that which were in their hand, and their earrings, which were in their ears, and Jacob hid them under the oak, which was by Shechem. So here these people come. Now, just it's like a car wash, right? Come in on the one side, you go through the car wash, but this car wash has a power spray. When you come out, even the Duco's gone. Everything's gone. This is a peculiar people. They're pale. The color is gone. The earrings, the lipstick, the mini dress. Here's a totally new people. They're weird. This is how they come out the other side. And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon them. Isn't that incredible? Upon the cities that were around them, and they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. God will put the fear of God into them. So Jacob came to Luz, which is in the land of Canaan, that is Bethel, and all the people that were with him. Here's this corporate nature. He built an altar. He called the place El, Bethel, because there God appeared unto him when he fled from the face of his brother. But Deborah Rebecca's nurse died there. I like the Bible. This is a maid. A maid. Here is Jacob. He's sort of the king of this family. And here's a maid. A servant girl. And she was buried beneath Bet El under an oak. And the name of it was called Alon Bakut. And God appeared unto Jacob again, and he came out of Paddan Aram and blessed him. And God sent unto him, thy name is Jacob. Thy name shall not be called more Jacob, but Israel shall be thy name. And he called his name Israel. So he went from being a deceiver to being one who wrestled with God. Incredible. And from the highest to the lowest, they are knit together in a family. There they bury Deborah. What does this Alon Bakut mean? It means oak of weeping. So what did the children of God do for a maidservant? They wept for days when that person died. I like Wesley's note. Wesley writes, there he buried Deborah, Rebecca's nurse. We have reason to think that Jacob, after he came to Canaan, while his family dwelt in Shechem, went himself to visit his father Isaac at Hebron. Rebecca probably was dead, but her old nurse, of whom mention is made, survived her. And Jacob took her to his family. While there at Bethel, she died, and died lamenting. So much lamented that the oak under which he was buried was called Alon Bakut, the oak of weeping. How do we love the brethren? Intensely, from the highest to the lowest. Is there not one Father to us all? Has not one God created us? Why do we act deceitfully, each man with his brother, to profane the covenant of our fathers? Malachi 2:10. The church is the lesson school for relationships. Learn it here. If no one is not willing to give up self is fit for heaven, then how do we deal with our differences? How do we get to the point where we are willing to lay down our life for the brethren? That's tough. But I say that whoever is angry with his brother, without a cause. Unless, of course, you have a what? A new translation. Man, I don't even understand how people can't see that there must be a point to all of this. If the new translations are correct, really now, I'm being dead serious. If the new translations are correct, everybody's going to be doomed to hellfire. And I'm not talking about that everlasting hell, but that instant annihilation. Nobody's going to make it if the new translation is correct. It cannot be correct. Because he says, everybody who is angry with his brother shall be liable to the judgment. Man, everybody's going to be angry with his brother at some stage. It says there, without a cause. And whoever shall say to his brother, Raka Fu, shall be liable to the Sanhedrin. But whoever shall say, fool, shall be liable to be thrown into the fire of hell. That's powerful stuff. Therefore, if you offer your gift on the altar and there remember that your brother has anything against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Do what you can. If your brother says to you, get lost, I'm not interested, that's not your problem. It's not your problem. But why do you judge your brother? Or also, why do you despise your brother? But Lord, look what he's doing. He's apostate. Look what he's doing. I mean, I despise him. He's despicable. Excuse me, how do you know he's not going to repent from that? You might have to live with him forever. If you despise him here, are you going to despise him in heaven as well? For all shall stand before the judgment seat of Christ. That's the Lord's business. It's not my business. We've got to get our attitudes right in this church. Then let us not judge one another anymore, but rather judge this, not to put a stumbling block or an offense towards his brother. Romans 14:13. The Bible is full of it. And why do you look on the splinter that is in your brother's eye, but you do not consider the beam that is in your own eye? I think there are enough beams in my eye to keep me busy forever. Or how will you say to your brother, let me pull the splinter out of your eye, and behold, there's a beam in your own eye? Hypocrite! First get rid of the beam in your eye, and then you'll see clearly to see the splinter in your brother's eye. If your brother shall trespass against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone, and if he hears you, you've gained your brother. If he doesn't hear you, tough. Take heed to yourself. If your brother trespass against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. How often must I forgive him? Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me? He had a problem with the brethren too, I think. Till seven times? Wishful thinking, eh? And Jesus said unto him, I say unto thee, until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Okay, 490 times I have to forgive my brother. No. Until the close of probation. Because 490, the 70 weeks, was the close of probation for Israel as a nation. So I must forgive my brother until the close of probation. I can't get out of it. Not seven times, not 490 times. Over and over and over and over again. And the worse the brother is, the more he builds character. And Jesus answered, I tell you not seven times, but 77 times. NIV. Huh. Now, I have a serious problem with that. I don't know why some scribes don't have a problem with that, but there goes a typology right out of the Bible. Would you agree? This is serious. I said I wouldn't give a lecture of it, but I didn't say I wouldn't sneak it into every lecture. The brethren have to suffer with me too. Why should I just suffer with the brethren? Matthew 18:23-35. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. But for as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him his debt. But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 pence. Pittance. Wow. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me that thou owest. And the fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay thee. And he would not, and went and cast him into the prison till he should pay his debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry and came and told unto their Lord all that was done. Who is the first servant? It's me. Me. I have no right to eternal life. I blew it. And he forgave me. How much more must I forgive my brother? The Lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt because thou desirest me. Should not thou also have compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? What is a blow here and there compared to what the Lord took from us individually. It's nothing. It's nothing. We must love each other in this church. Make it a life task to love the worst of the brethren the most. For which of your children do you pray the most? The best of them or the worst of them? Help me. Why can't you do the same for the brethren? Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. We've dealt with this text before. Again, the NIV, confess your sins one to another. We've been through it. Can't be right. Acknowledge your faults one to another, says the Geneva Bible. Acknowledge your faults one to another. We have to admit that we have faults. We have faults. The apostle says, confess your faults one another. Pray for one another that you may be healed. Confess your sins to God alone. We've dealt with this text in another lecture. Those who have not humbled their souls before God in acknowledging their guilt have not yet fulfilled the first condition of acceptance. Problem is here. Problem is not there. And whenever we have conflict with the brethren, the problem is here. The problem is not there. That's the Lord's problem. This is my problem. Confession of sin, whether public or private, should be heartfelt and freely expressed. And if we are wrong, admit it. We're not perfect. Everybody of us makes mistakes. It's not to be urged from the sinner. It is not to be made in a flippant and careless way or forced from those who have no realizing sense of the abhorrent character of sin. We have lots of them in the church that don't even know they're doing wrong. How can you force them to admit that something is wrong that they don't perceive to be wrong? That's up to the Lord. The confession that is the outpouring of the inmost soul finds its way to God of the infinite piety. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of broken heart, and save us such that are of contrite spirit. So what do I do if my brother is really off track and I have done all of the above and examined myself whether I'm acting according to the principle of love? What do I do? I have written to you not to associate intimately if any man called a brother and is either a fornicator or covetous or idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner, with such do not eat. Now we command you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourself from every brother who walks disorderly. I don't have to be schleck schleck cushy cushy with everybody who hates everything that is righteousness, but I must love him. Yet do not count him as an enemy. See, the Lord's cute. He always puts it in there. Do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. Admonish him. Tell him, listen, I don't agree with what you do. I don't like what you're doing. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judges his brother speaketh evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. Leave the judgment to God. The church is made up of persons of different temperaments, various dispositions. They have come from different denominations. The cleaver of truth has separated one here, one there, from a great quarry of the world. And the church of Christ, all these various members must be cemented together by the Spirit of God. There must be some glue, right? If the love of Christ is in the hearts of the members of the church, through the abundant grace of Christ, there will be oneness, unity amongst the brethren. We must close the door of the heart to every suggestion that shall have the least tendency towards keeping us from a state of harmony. Wow. Selfishness is sin. It grieves away the Spirit of God. When we cherish unkind thoughts, harbor suspicions against our brethren, we are cutting ourselves off from the channel of God, light and love. How many people don't say to me, I'm working with these people, but I'm not going to bring them to the church? And why not? Because the church is horrible. The church is this. The church doesn't teach right. The Sabbath school is a catastrophe. This, that, and the other. I've learned some marvelous lessons in this church how God works. My wife and I were talking to a lady, and we said, we have this great speaker coming. Oh, it was a long time ago. He was a magnificent speaker. One of the GC men who had been to islands and had experiences like you cannot believe, discovered tribes, whole groups becoming Adventists. He was really magnificent. And she said, I will not come to your church if they say one thing about Adventism or the truth or anything. I want nothing to do with it. I only want to listen to those talks. We said, come. And she said, if he says one word, I will make such a row, I'll make such a noise, I'll get up and I'll walk out and I'll make such a fuss, your whole meeting will be destroyed. We said, come. She came. She sat between me and my wife. And this guy was lecturing, showing slides and talking. And he talked only on his experiences of the islands and the island people and the this and the that and the other. And then suddenly he switched and he started talking about the church and everything. And my heart sank. And I looked to my wife and she was sitting between us, right? Fast asleep. And this man talked for half an hour on what he didn't want to hear. And then he went back into his lecture and she was wide awake. And after the lecture we asked her, well, what was it like? She said it was fantastic. And I'm so pleased. He never said a word about any of those things. She became a friend of the church. So who was in control of that little episode? God. I've learned that God closes ears, closes eyes to things that shouldn't be seen. And if those things sometimes that you perceive chase you out of the church, then the problem lies there. Leave it to God. He knows what he's doing. In brotherly love to one another, loving fervently, having led one another in honor. But regarding brotherly love, you do not need that I write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. Let brotherly love continue. Brethren and sisters in the faith, does the question arise in your heart, am I my brother's keeper? If you claim to be children of God, you are your brother's keeper. Yes, we are our brother's keeper. If you claim to be children of God, you are your brother's keeper. The Lord holds the church responsible for the souls whom they might be the means of saving. We are our brother's keeper. Wow. That means the worst of them, right? The great outpouring of the Spirit of God, which lightens the whole earth with His glory, will not come until we have an enlightened people that know by experience what it means to be laborers together with God. When we have entire wholehearted consecration to the service of Christ, God will recognize the fact by an outpouring of His Spirit without measure. But this will not be while the largest portion of the church are not laborers together with God. God cannot pour out His Spirit when selfishness, self-indulgence are manifest. When a spirit prevails that if I put into words would express the answer of Cain, am I my brother's keeper? Wow, we have to change our attitude. Brotherly love, there's too much of an independence of spirit indulged in amongst the messengers. This must be laid aside. There must be a drawing together of the servants of God. There's been too much of a spirit of ask, am I my brother's keeper? Said the angel, yea, thou art thou brother's keeper. Thou shouldst have a watchful care for thy brother. Be interested for his welfare. Cherish a kind, loving spirit towards him. And the worse he is, the more so. Just like you pray more for your wayward children than you do for the ones that are straight. Press together, press together. God designed that man should be open-hearted and honest, without affection, meek, humble, with simplicity. This is the principle of heaven. God ordered it so. Does this mean that we become wishy-washy and we don't rebuke sin? No. We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly and the love of every one of you all abounds towards each other. I think that's the perfect text to end this lecture with. The brethren, may God give us strength. Amen.